And so when we start looking at well water, first we need to really define what a well is. And so by definition, you see there, a well is a deep hole or shaft sunk into the ground to obtain water, gas, or oil. And today we'll be talking about water, so we'll forego the oil and gas today. But a lot of times when I think of a well, we think of the well on the left-hand side with the bucket, and we lower that down into the water or the aquifer. We get the water and we pull it back up, pour it into another bucket, and that's our water source. And so that's the what we call a bored well, and generally it's the 3 foot in diameter. The one we typically use for homeowners is the one on the right. So it's a shaft, either bored or drilled down into the aquifer itself. And you can see here's our topsoil. And then depending on where you are in the state of Georgia or across the nation, this limestone, shale, sand, and gravel is going to vary. So if you're here in North Georgia, for instance, you'll have a small area of topsoil, and then you'll go down and you'll hit more of your limestone and your granite. Whereas in South Georgia, most of that's going to be a limestone and sand and gravel aquifer. But we'll have the shaft that goes in, and this blue here is what we call the aquifer. So the well itself will go down into the aquifer, and you see the pump here, a submersible pump, will be installed in that casing or in that well to pump the water out. So when we start looking at these aquifers, an aquifer is just an underground area where water is contained, and water fills up the pore spaces. So anything, when we look at soil and you pick up soil, a handful of soil, so think about sand for the easy aspect of it. When you pick up a handful of sand, you know those sand particles don't touch each other. They touch each other, but they aren't forming a complete cohesive group. And so there's areas between there. When we get into the aquifer or below the aquifer level, or in what we see here, the potentiometric surface, below that area, all those spaces in between those sand particles or clay particles are full of water. And so that becomes what we call a potentiometric surface or the water table. And so as you see here in this picture, we're looking at three different types of wells: an artesian well here on the left, a flowing artesian well there in the middle, and then just a water table well here on the right. The artesian well and the flowing artesian well, you notice that the top of the artesian well is above what we call the potentiometric surface. The potentiometric surface is that area where this water here in the confined aquifer layer wants to be. So it's putting pressure from uphill, if you want to look at it that way, and trying to push water up into this well. And as you notice, it only gets up to this potentiometric surface or this area or this elevation that water can be pushed up to. Here in the middle, in this flowing artesian well, you notice that the mouth of this well is below or right at that potentiometric surface. And so as the pressure from, again, quote unquote, uphill is pushing that water up this well, and it wants to be, like I said earlier, this potentiometric surface, it pushes water out of that well. This water table well is not in this, what we call a confined aquifer. So the water table is right here, this blue line, as you see. And so the well is showing us the true water table elevation in that well. So if you have a well and you install a well, this is going to be for a home system specifically what that might look like. So you would have the casing or the well drilled down into the aquifer. You have your submersible pump. That water would then be pumped into, in a home situation, typically a pressurized tank, and then that pressurized tank would push that water to your house. And you see the pressure switch here, that controls when the pump comes off and on based on the pressure here in the tank. This here on the right is a cutout that we got from Virginia Tech a couple years ago, or a picture of a cutout we got from Virginia Tech a couple years ago when we went up there. And it just shows the casing here is the white pipe, the PVC pipe, our pump, And then this bubble is a stabilizer. So it just keeps the line that pushes the water out, or the PVC pipe that we get the water out of the well in, just in the center of the well casing itself. So there's a couple of different things we look at when we look at wells. I mentioned the confined aquifer earlier. So if we have what we call a deep well, and we're drilled down into two or three different aquifers, different depth aquifers, this might be what your well looks like. Here in Georgia, typically this is what a South Georgia well would look like, where we drill down through the superficial aquifer here at the top. We drill through an impermeable layer, whatever that may be, in South Georgia, with heavy clays or limestone or something to that effect. And then you get down into the lower aquifer itself. When we drill through this impermeable layer, we also put a grout layer in there to keep water movement from the lower aquifer to the upper aquifer, or vice versa. And then we put a screen in, and the water then in this lower aquifer goes through the screen, and then we have a pump in here, we pump it out. One thing we want to do, and definitely want to do, is grout that impermeable layer. Again, like I said, we don't want water from the upper aquifer getting into the lower aquifer, especially if there's contamination from, in this case, we have an outhouse, but this could be any other source of possible pollution. Now, typically in North Georgia and some other places, we may have an impermeable layer that could be granite or shale or some other rock formation that we might not be able to drill through. And then so we would put a bored well, in this case, typically down to that impermeable layer. And what we're pulling out is superficial aquifer water. Again, we can drill down through this impermeable layer, and I'll show you a picture of that in just a little bit, what that might look like. But a lot of bored wells, and we see a lot of these in North Georgia, where these are that 3 foot or so in diameter, and we have the potential then of getting a lot of contamination from the surface. So when we start talking then about well maintenance and protection, what are we looking at? And when we start looking at maintenance, the first thing we want to look at is if you've got a good well itself, the casing's good, you want to make sure there's a good cap on that casing. And the caps can come in two different forms. This form here, and then you've got the more contained cap. Both caps, the purpose of them is to keep surface water out of that well, to keep any kind of insects, rats, snakes, or anything out of that well itself. In this case, if, for instance, if you're spraying fertilizers or pesticides around, you want to make sure those don't get down in the well. And you definitely don't want pets getting in that well, and either getting stuck or whatever, in that well itself. So the next picture here is one with that cap you saw on the left there. This is a well itself. Here's the well casing coming out of the ground. And a typical well would have the electrical connections here. This well seal, again, protects any water from getting into that well and contaminating the aquifer itself. You'll have a pump tag here letting you know who put that well in, how deep it is, and a lot of different information about that well itself. One thing you also want to have on there is you notice here this tap, and it doesn't have threads on it like we normally see with a hose bib. And the purpose of that is we can still take water samples out of the well here, but we definitely don't want to hook a hose pipe or anything up to it and use this as our water source. This is always good to have because when Stephanie talks about well water testing, we a lot of times want to get a well water sample, and a good well water sample will tell us what's happening in the aquifer itself and not in the piping going to the house. So having something like this on the well itself will allow us to get water straight out of the well. Now, when we start looking at well caps, there's always the good and the bad. I just mentioned on a previous slide that we definitely want the well cap and the well itself to extend above the ground surface. So you notice on this left-hand one, this well is actually down below ground surface. This pipe coming up here is a way, I guess, to get water out of that tap itself. Whereas this one on the right has that good well seal. It's above the ground level. And so when we start looking at maintenance of these well caps, we definitely don't want something on the, like we see on the left, but we definitely want something that we have on the right. Again, to keep as much water out of that well itself from the surface. So some of the other things we look at when we talk about maintenance is maintaining the area around the well and keeping it clean and accessible. So you see the one on the left there is a home operation. So we've got a good pad around the well itself, which is here. We have our pressurized tank. The grass is mowed around it. And so it's well maintained. And this agricultural setup, the same thing. You've got a good pad there. You've got the pump here. I'm in all the electrical components, but just maintaining it around so that it protects potentially anything from getting down into that well itself. Now, when we start looking at some other things, one of the things we definitely want to try to keep away from our wells, and we do want to keep away from our wells, are chemicals, gasoline, fertilizers, and we want to try to keep those at least 50 foot away. These two situations probably don't meet that situation. And so you have the fertilizer tank here, which should be in a containerized system or a secondary containment. If, for instance, something would happen here, there would be the possibility of that fertilizer getting down this well casing, either from the top or potentially under this pad, even though the pad looks good. And you see the gasoline or some other kind of organic-based compound here near the well head. So we definitely want to keep those away from our well head. The other thing we want to do is try to divert it as best we can, divert surface water away from that well. So this picture here on the left, you notice this little bit of a hill leading up to the well casing itself and the good pad around it. So if we happen to have water coming in from around this well, that gives us another inch or two that keeps the water from hitting that well casing and potentially going straight down that well casing. This pad also does that same thing, but we want to try to divert water away from the well head and not into the well. And again, this is another agricultural setup. Again, you see the pad there, and it keeps that water away from that well casing itself. So then when we start looking at well water, some of the issues we can have, especially with our well systems, is does our pump continually cycle? And I'll show you on the next slide, you know, what are some of those troubleshooting things that we look at when we have a continually cycling pump, when our water pressure drops, the water has a strange odor or taste in it, are there particles in our water? And then do we have a damaged casing, and what does that mean for our well water? Again, there's a lot of words on this slide, and I know, but I just want to go over one or two of them. So if there's sand in the water, the possible cause in could be an improperly constructed well or a hole in the well screen. So a lot of times when we get comments or questions from citizens and homeowners, it's I've got a lot of sediment in my well water. What could be happening there? The second one, pump turns off rapidly, off and on. You know, if you've got a pressurized tank, you may have more water in there and there's not that air bubble to help buffer some of that. So that's one of the things you might want to look at. And then here at the very bottom, I'll skip down to it, well damage. So if you get sometimes a lot of potentially total coliform or bacteria or sediment, you know, did somebody happen to go out and bump that well casing? And if you bump that well casing, not knowing it, it could loosen up that well casing and let water run down the side of that casing straight down to the aquifer where the pump is in. And so those are just some of the things we look at when we talk to homeowners as when they come in with a well water problem. So when we start then looking at well water testing and analysis, why do we want to test the well water? Some of the things is we can't see the chemicals that potentially are there. So if you have one of those surficial aquifer wells, for instance, and somebody sprayed something on the ground, and I'm not saying what it could be, but if that is a very aqueous based compound, it potentially could get down into that surficial aquifer with those red dots like you saw and get into your well. Bacteria and some other pathogens can't be seen. So maybe just looking at your water, it looks clean, but you could have pathogens or bacteria in that water. nitrogen, nitrates, and those things can't be seen in the water. And then sometimes if the water looks bad and it's got a lot of particles in it and a lot of sediment, it's just sediment and there's nothing else there. So maybe just filtering out that sediment would take care of that problem. So doing the well water test allows us to know what's in that water. So then we can start working with homeowners on what is the next step we need to take in looking at how to potentially remedy the problem. So just some reminders. When you have a well, depending on which state you're in, the state has general guidelines and general well water regulations. And so each state's going to be a little bit different, but you can look it up in your state regulations, talk to a well water driller. Some extension has and can get you that information as well. So just knowing what the requirements are for well water will allow you, if you're putting in a new well, to know what to look for. Or if you have an older house or if you've bought a house, knowing what that well should look like regulation-wise would help. One of the other reminders then is, again, have a good well water, a well seal on there. So again, what this does is it protects any surface water from getting down in that well and in that aquifer. Keep the area around the well clean. Again, so this one you see a little bit of grass growing under it, but it's been killed. But keep it around so that you can see what's going on around that well itself. Make sure you got a good pad around the well head. This is one of the ones I showed earlier where it's got that little lip and it protects it. This is this middle picture is probably not a very good well cap. Obviously a pallet doesn't protect very much from getting into it. This one actually has a good pad around it, but you can also notice that water has undercut it. So this pad is good, but it really doesn't help very much. So we definitely don't want those two things. And we want to make sure we got a good well pad around that well head. Another reminder is make sure you don't store chemicals, fuels, or anything near that well within 50 feet. That way, if there is a spill, it doesn't have the potential of running down that well casing. And then we want to make sure we test the water. Generally, we say on an annual basis, like we get annual checkups, checking your well water is not a bad thing, just to kind of give us trends in case there's a problem down the line. We can go back and say, what has your well water been looking like in the past and see where we are. And with that, I'm going to finish up again. My name is Gary Hawkins. I'm the Water Resource Management Specialist here at the University of Georgia in the Crop and Soil Science Department. If you have any questions, there's my contact information.